now you're going to hear one of these stories today, because each woman's story is unique and they contributed in their own special way. Now, how many out there know who Molly Pitcher was?
Revolutionary.
Yeah, she was the one in the Revolutionary War who followed her husband, and at the Battle of Monmouth, her husband was wounded. He was on the cannons, but she had been bringing water to the front lines because it was so hot. And then when her husband became wounded, she took over his place in the cannons. So she was, you know, a combat woman even before we just now. And so we have our own Molly Pitcher here. Ruth Hoffman was the featured subject of the Molly Pitcher posters that were published by the Pennsylvania Railroad. During the war, Ruth worked for the railroad, and recently Janet and I and Linda had a pleasure of talking with her about her experiences in that job. Her stories are wonderful, and they provide important insight into the life and times of that era of our history. You will learn, if you don't already know, that Ruth was and still is an adventuresome sort of woman who never batted an eye at challenges. She made her own path in life, never even noticing the more constricted path that society had cut out for her to follow. Now, because there's so many people here, we were gonna just sit, and I guess, do you wanna stand or do you wanna sit? Because a voice projection into the back of the room. We wanna make sure everybody can hear.
If you can't hear back there, just come forward. I will wander, although I'm wired, and I don't know how far I can wander.
Oh, you can wander. That's more for me. Okay. All right. Let's start. What were you doing when the U.S. entered World War II? How old were you, and what were you doing?
I was in high school, and the young men that I went to high school were, of course, being drafted and moving off into various forms of the service. And I often think about that, because I thought, then they started the WACs and the WAVES, and you could be a WAC if you were 18 years old. But to be a WAVE, I think you had to be 25 or somewhere around that. And I wanted to be a WAVE if I was going to do that, because I looked better in navy blue than I did khaki. You know, you approach life within your own context, which is limited, quite limited. At any rate, I just knew people, and the boys were disappearing, boys, because that's what they were in those days. Life, when I talked about this time period, it was a whole different world that we lived in. And it's very difficult to understand. I may use terminology or say things to you. I don't want to offend anyone, but we didn't live as we live today. We had a whole different culture. And I remember my father saying, as we grew up, he used to say, our generation has lived somewhat like the generation before it, but things are changing so quickly and rapidly that your generation is going to be hit with change, 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 and it will just come very quickly. And at the time, I think of this because when we were children, my father belonged to a scientific society. He didn't necessarily have to have a science background or whatever in Philadelphia, but he would come home and say, well, we cooked the roast tonight, but it was still raw looking, but it was cooked. And we would laugh and laugh and laugh. And I'm talking about the early 30s. And then he talked about how they had a box and they could switch on and there'd be pictures in this box. Well, that was the TV. So everybody thought after the war, these are all, wow, new things. But these things were in the making. And when my father used to talk about that, in those days we had radio, not TV. And Buck Rogers was one of the programs that I listened to. And Buck Rogers had a flying dog. I wanted a flying dog. But nobody seemed to know anything about flying dogs. And even when my husband was alive, and I'd say, how soon can I get a flying dog, Hoffman? And which way do I go when I go up? To the right or to the left?
No, you're good. I will. So you were going to go to Temple University, right? But you decided to get a job at the time. So tell us how you got the job on the railroad.
One of our neighbors across the street, first of all, you have to know, I climbed every tree in Philadelphia. I climbed every lamppost in Philadelphia. I sat on the top. I don't know why I climbed, but I climbed. In fact, the police picked me up once sitting on top of one of the lampposts and took me home, and I was told not to do that again. I don't know whether I did or didn't. But I did a lot of climbing, and apparently one of our neighbors came across and asked if they'd speak to my parents. Well, we knew who he was, of course. And he said, could Ruth, would you be interested in coming down to the railroad? Because we are losing the men very quickly, and we need to fill some of these jobs. We think you might be interested. And one would be a passenger brakeman. A passenger brakeman was the person who punched your tickets on the train. And I said, oh, I'd like to do that. So I went down, and I was introduced to the superintendent of the Pennsylvania Railroad in Philadelphia at that time. And they discussed the fact that they were losing people, and that would I be interested in trying to be a passenger brakeman? I said I would. Well, I remember showing up at the railroad station, and there were photographers there from the major newspapers. And then someone said, how old is she? Because you had to be 25 to be a passenger brakeman. And that eliminated me right away, because I was either just past 17 or into my 18th year. Then back to the drawing board, as they would say sometime. And we went back to the superintendent's office, and we talked, and he said, we are losing the brakeman, we are losing everyone working the railroad. You have to understand, in Philadelphia, there was an area called the 52nd Street Railroad Yards. That's not quite right, but when I remember it, I'll tell you. It was the largest freight distribution yard in the world at the time. And they had brakemen, they had switch tenders, you had people working in the towers. And they asked me if I would be interested in trying to work as a switch tender in a tower. And I said that I would. So they assigned me to a switch tower at 52nd and Lancaster, which, as I said, was the largest freight distribution yard in the world. And I went there, and the word was posted. I posted in the switch tower, learning, you know, turn and whatever to direct the cars as they went off the pump. And that's another story. But after about 3 weeks in there, even though I qualified for the job, I was in an area where, as I said, this was the largest freight distribution yard in the world, but I would see the men coming off the hump. Now, the hump is where these trains backed up, and very slowly, but the cars would be marked and cut by one or by two, and there'd be a brakeman at the top of each car or two cars. And the brakeman, by the way, had what looked like a baseball bat. And they climbed up, and you know the wheels on the top of it? That's the brake for that particular car. And of course, I didn't know that at the time. But they would come down off the hump on these cars, and they would go into various parts of the yard below to make up another freight train. And I'm not talking, again, about a small space. I'm talking about a large space. But when they went down off the hump on the top of those cars, every once in a while one would wave to me, or sometimes someone would come down singing away, and I thought, that's what I want to do. I want to get on those cars and ride off the hump. And so I mentioned that, but they didn't think. They said, well, maybe we could try. We've not thought about this, but we have to get someone to work the switches that are out in the various parts of the yard, manual switches. They didn't know whether a woman could do this or anything. I said, well, let me try. So I had to back up. I'm incoherent.
No, you're doing great. You're doing great.
What I think is kind of funny, you know, I came out of a different era. We didn't do this. We wore dresses. Which brings up the fact that one of our young friends, we all sewed in those days. Everybody sewed. Someone in the family sewed, and they'd come and stay with you for a week because you sewed. Everybody may wear clothes. You cut up fur coats, you made fur collars, whatever. But one day, a friend came up, and she said to my mother said, "What are you wearing?" And her genius said, "I'm wearing slacks." And my mother said, "What are they?" And then Regina said, "This is the way things are going to move, and women are going to wear slacks. They're going to have to wear slacks to work." And my mother said, "I will never wear slacks." In those days, you wore your house dress with your apron. You did not wear slacks. Somewhere along the way, you did. But my mother, someone got her to put a pair of slacks on. And I remember my mother looking down and then doing different things, and she said, "I'm never taking these off." Life was changing. At any rate, how did I get away from that into slacks? Anyway, they sent me up to a switching job called the 59th Street Switch, and I went from the, let me back up again because when I started to work in the tower at that first switching job, the day that I finished the work, I went back to the office and stood at the desk where this man kind of assigned people or did assign people, and he said, "We'll see you tomorrow." And I said, "Tomorrow? Tomorrow's Saturday." And he said, "Do you think, sorry, but I'm not that funny, don't run on Saturday." Well, it opened up my mind because you get on trains, you get on trolleys, you get on buses, and you don't realize it doesn't matter whether it's Monday or Sunday or what time of the day it is. So it opened up a whole new world, and I showed up the next morning. Anyway, then I eventually graduated or said, "Let me try switching outside. I think I would like that better than being in a tower." I didn't like the confinement. I just didn't care for it. So they said, "Well, we'll send you to this one switching job." So I went to the new switching job, 59th Street. And why I remember 59th Street, I have no idea. But I had to walk for, say, 10 minutes to get to it. And then when I got up there, it was a nice man, and he introduced himself. And he told me they had, they looked like shanties with two wooden places to sit down on the inside and a potbelly stove. I had never seen a potbelly stove in my life. And he said, "Now, I'm going to show you how to put the wood in or the coal, whichever it was at the time, I don't recall." And all I kept thinking was, "I can't do this. I don't know how to take that thing out and put coal in or what." I learned. Then he took me outside and said, "Now, this is a switching ring. First, when you get here, the first thing you do is you take this globe and you clean it. And this is how you clean it, and you fill out the bottom part with oil, and you put the globe back in there. Here, when a train is coming, this is a stop, and you use your oil lamp to stop. If a train's coming, you want to top the move. This was an okay signal, and back up. I already forget what backup is, but I don't have to work there anymore." But when I approached these things, I think I was really quite calm. But inside I thought, "I can't do this, but I will do this." And I did do it. And I did it very quickly, and it was no problem. I was further away from the hump where they did the classified the cars from the train as they moved over. But I was far enough out that every once in a while I would get a stranger into my little shack. And I remember one night, well, some were bums, you know, they were catching rides on freight trains. And once in a while, but one night when, I remember this young man came, and I think he was young, and we sat and we talked, and all of a sudden he jumped up, he said, "Oh my God, you're a woman." Now, when I went to work, of course, I had long hair. We all have long hair in those days. Well, everybody has long hair today. But I took my hair and put it up, wrapped it in a red bandana, and put a layer of cap down, exactly as it is in the picture. So I could have been any gender, it didn't matter, because we all looked the same. At any rate, I remember the poor young thing, whoever he was, he jumped up and just ran out. But that was one of the jobs that I had to learn, and I think when I look back on it, it never occurred to me that I couldn't do any of these things. I looked at them and I was overwhelmed with their newness because I didn't know that kind of life. But I did it and I loved being outside. And as far as moving the switches, I was a phys ed, you know, I was going to school and you know, we're strong people. We can stand on our hands, we can do somersaults, we can hang from the rings, etc. So that physically, I was in good shape. Once in a while, I would come on some of those jobs where I had to walk maybe 5 minutes or 10 minutes to the job, but if there was a freight train coming, sometimes I would run and catch the freight train and jump up on it and ride with it as it passed whatever switching job or if anyone. Now I think about it, and I think about it with horror. I remember once there was what they call a double header. It means they had to have two engines because the load was so heavy, or even two pushing as well as pulling. And one night, this one was moving kind of fast, but I can get on that. And I ran hard, and I did get up on one of those engines. And when I walked in, and the engineer turned around, he said, "Oh my God, where did you come from?" Well, then he said, "I can't slow down. I've got too heavy a train. I will do the best I can." And I said, "I will get off, don't worry." And I did get off. Now, if ever you're catching a freight car, what you need to know is you don't just jump off. You swing your body so that you're going in the same direction as the train, so that when you get off, and we laughed because we knew it was moving fast, because when you were getting off and you were running, your feet hit your buttocks, and you knew that was a bit fast, and you shouldn't have gotten on that train to begin with. How did I get into that?
Tell us how your parents felt when you said, "I got a job on the railroad."
Well, my mother didn't seem to mind too much, but I remember one night my father was quite, well, kind of upset. He didn't move out of his chair with his newspaper, you understand, but he said, "No young lady would work on the railroad." And I said, I had 1 foot ready to run. I said, "I ain't no lady and I'm going," and I tore out. We didn't talk like that then, and we certainly didn't talk like that to our parents. And I went. But when I first started, I worked the regular trick, which was like 4 o'clock to 12 o'clock at night. But then I had started school, and sometimes they needed someone, and they would call and say, "Can you work through from 12 o'clock to 8 at this switching job?" And I did. Often, I worked from 4 o'clock in the afternoon to 8 o'clock the next morning. I was young. It didn't make any difference. Anyway, it gave me money, which I liked. And I was going to school. But I have to tell you about one switching job called the C-yard. No, scratch that one. I don't know what, but the point is, there were certain trains that came from down from upper Pennsylvania, and they would come around the curve, and if for any reason they knew I was working that switching job, they'd say, "Is Ruth working there today or tonight?" whenever they were coming by. And somehow the word would get through, however they made the communication way. But where they came from, they had these open freshwater rivers and lakes, and the men would go by and they would get freshwater crab or fish. Then they would put it inside, they would cut a loaf of bread open and put it inside the loaf of bread, and then they would put it on the coal shovel and hold that end over the coals, and that's how they cooked that particular loaf of bread with the fish or the freshwater crab in it. But if they knew I was on, they would say, find out if Ruth wants one. And I would say, yes. Well, I would hear that steam engine coming. I love steam engines. I miss the steam engines, but, well, I miss the steam engines. But at any rate, I would hear this chirp, chirp, chirp coming up, and then I'd hear a hoo, a hoo. I'd think, I know who it is, and I would tear across these tracks because as they came around the bend, this bundle would fly out. And it was the freshwater crab or the freshwater fish in this loaf of bread, all cooked and ready to go. But I think of these things, and I think it's kind of neat. On the other hand, sometimes if I worked that particular job, it was close to the roundhouse where they did the repairs on the engines or whatever aspect of the railroad that needed that. But sometimes the men that worked there would have a break and they would come over and they would sit outside on a bench and we would talk, and it was always kind of, you know, talking of an era. They were talking in, it's broken English. I grew up in a city where there was a mixture, but you had your Italian section, your Polish section, your German section, and then this section where the people spoke English. These men would sit there and they would say, broken English and things. I shouldn't get on this one. But, well, anyway, the point was, they would sit and talk to me about different things and different ways. And then one day I said to them, because after a while I was a freshman at school, I knew everything. And I said, well, we don't need a lot of these things. We don't need all this. And somehow I said it. And, but the point was, they looked at me and they said, oh, Ruth, you don't want everything to be a textbook. They said it in a way, and I knew right away to get off that subject. Because I knew that we were moving into a different thing, a thought pattern. I had to add a little bit garbled because there was a bit more to it than that. But I met all kinds of people. I never once had any fear of any man or any woman or whatever, and we had a mixture of people on the railroad. I also, besides doing the outdoor switching jobs, I worked on I don't know, I can't remember the name. It was like a scooter and it was on a track. It's, you run it exactly like a car, but you didn't have a steering wheel. And you left the hump area where these cars were cut and distributed on the various tracks throughout this mileage of tracks below. But you took the scooter and you drove it like a car without steering, put it on tracks. You could drive it several miles, and you would pick up these men who got off these different cars, and they would hop on, and you would take them back up to the hump. That was one of the other jobs that I did, and sometimes I did that 16 hours, but it didn't matter.
Can you talk a little bit about, because you talked about working various shifts, which was a little different for women, and you work sometimes at night, and you had to go back home late at night, and you told us about the one time in the station.
Yes, well, in the large cities, unless you grow up in a large city and for some reason have a need, the underground is there. And unless you grow up in a large city and realize you can get off one elevated train or one subway, and you can walk for quite a long mile or distance to another. You can go, it's a whole city underneath. There are travel offices, newspaper places, small restaurants. This is all open, it's all underground. If it's a hard rain that day, you can get off your subway, you don't go upstairs, you just walk through this built-in area that you're not aware of and get to your next point without ever going above and upstairs. But one night, I was going in late and I knew I could get one more train that was leaving around 11 something out to where they wanted me to work. And I thought, well, I'll take the subway, I'll get up there, and I'll go through the underground. I had never, never been afraid in my life. But that night, there was nothing. I mean, I walked quite a distance underground. It's well lit, but I was extremely uneasy. I can't explain that, except I'm sure you have moments in your life when you're not sure. Are terribly uneasy, but I knew, don't run, just walk, but watch. And you know, I knew I could run fast, but you don't know what's ahead or what kind of a situation might evolve. At any rate, I kept walking, and finally I came into the part where the commuter trains were, and the offices and the ticket offices, all of which were closed. But I did see one of the brakemen over waiting at the gate for the next and the last train, which was the same one I was going to take out to that switching job. So I went right over to him, and even though I didn't know him, I didn't recognize him, I told him who I was, and he said to me, "You stand here and don't leave this spot." And I thought, now what's going to happen? And he went off, and in about 10 minutes or less, the next thing I know, he said to me, "I want you to come over and look at these men." There were six or seven men in a semicircle. They were human beings, but they weren't human beings. These people live underground. These people use other people. They're robbers, they're thieves, they're murderers. But he said to these men, and I knew right away, he knew all these men. And he told them who I was. He said, "If you ever see her, be sure she is safe wherever she is from one point to another." I knew I could walk anywhere underground in Philadelphia at that particular point, and I was okay. But it's a lifestyle and a different kind of a person that you're not aware of because you don't live that kind of life. So, what else?
How long did you work on the railroad?
At least four years because it put me through school. So I would say a little bit over the 4 years. And I enjoyed it. There was a yard. CR switching job, which they would send me to. I could not do it, and I explained that to them, but it didn't matter. I could not do that one. But sometimes I would work a switching job, as I said, from 4 o'clock in the afternoon through to 8 in the morning. Ah, now there was a job on the hump. The hump is where they cut the cars, and the brakeman sat up there and took one or two cars down to whichever location had to go to. And where I sat was on a stool, and in front of me was a door, usually open, so I could see out, and a large window, because whatever his title was, he had something to do with the way these things were cut. And then beside me was a window, and right behind me was a door, which opened in and out. But the point is, that there was a ladder attached to that door that dropped you 8 or 10 feet to the ground. Once in a while, I would climb up the ladder, but basically I would just walk up the hump if I was on the hump switching job. But one night when I was on the job, and I was sitting there, a man came and went right in front of me and out the window. I thought, holy mackerel, what's this guy doing? But the next thing I knew, they were going out the windows and doors behind me, over me, and then someone yelled, "A munitions train broke loose." Well, the munition train broke loose, half of Philadelphia would have gone in that area. But the men that were sitting there waiting for cars or whatever, they tore out, they got up on that train and they stopped it. But I never forgot that because I didn't know what was going on. I was sitting on my stool doing my switching job, and all I knew, people were going by me every direction, just out the windows and out the doors. Guess it would have been a big bang. So, little by little. But I did not discuss this with my parents. I went alone. I think when I look back on this, and I think, put, how often don't you sometimes go into a job? Today we're a little bit more civilized. We explain to people how things work. We don't just say, here's an oil lamp, here's this, you know, this is stop, this is go, and this is okay. One night, I think the only night that I felt, when I think about it now, I'm not big on the electric engines, but you know, they're probably a lot safer and they're powerful. But one night they called and said, we've got a double header coming up and a pusher, double pusher. Keep that train going. Don't screw it up. And I had all my switches set up and everything was fine. And I got out on the track and gave them the okay. And they acknowledged the okay, but they were slowing down. And I thought, I am going to be killed. This guy is slowing down and it's not my fault. And I tore back into my little shack with the phone and said, I've got a problem here. They're slowing down. It's not me. We know because they said there is another train on the same track coming down. And, well, and they said, can you set up the other switches so that we can get this train diverted? I said, I can do that. Well, I tore out and I got the other switches turned out. And then I moved down on the track to give an okay to this double header coming up, and they signaled that they got my, and they knew that I had put the other switches. But I stepped off the track, and about 10 feet behind me was a double header electric train, which no one knew had been switched onto the wrong track. I could have been mush, and I don't hear them. And anyway, they don't have the same kinds of whistles that the electric trains. You know, when you hear the electric, they, that, kind of the old steam engine, it's more magic, and it's nice, and the men were great. One of the things that I would hear from people say, oh, those men must be tough. And I'd say, they're wonderful, and they were wonderful. And when I explained to them that the one engineer and his fireman, I was very fond of them, but the fireman was also a dancer with a ballet in Philadelphia. Oh. So you had a mixture here. You didn't just have a whatever. Now going off the hump, it was, you know, they just cut these trains into different, and what else can I tell you except that I was never afraid except the one time when there was an electric behind me and I didn't even hear it. There were two or three other women that worked not in the switching but in other forms. I met a couple women that had I think they were prostitutes, but they worked there, and they were very good and very kind to me. They looked out after me. In fact, before I left the railroad, the one was murdered over the period of time. But I met all kinds of people, and I think there's some marvelous people out there. And they're in all types of jobs. One time I did climb up on one of the freight cars, got a baseball bat, and I knew I could ride that car down into the yard where, well, I didn't get off the car. They were furious. What else should I tell?
Well, I think we should open it up for questions from the audience now, because
okay.
I think there are some.
Oh, I see them.
How did the railroad get you involved in the posters and the publicity?
Oh, yeah, I don't hear that thing.
The
yeah.
posters and the publicity campaigns and so on. How did they
How
get
did that
you
happen?
Involved
Oh,
in
I didn't
that?
Even know about that. One day they said, do you mind if we take a picture of you throwing a switch? And then they seemed to be concerned that I could do this. And I said, well, I can throw the switch. There's no problem. And I did it. By the way, that's exactly the way I look. Exactly, except for the jacket. That's a leather jacket. I wore a denim jacket that somebody that was in the Navy trained threw out the window, and that's what I wore. everybody else got it. There was no difference. And I was treated like that. When they came on work, they would yell out your name and which station you were to go to. I never felt any different from anybody. You know what? Maybe I was, but I didn't know it.
Did women ever work on the trains as firemen or brakemen?
I'm sorry, I lost my hearing aid.
Oh.
The kids are mad at me, but I got one.
I can use my teacher voice. Did you ever know of women who worked on the train as firemen or brakemen during the war?
Brakemen, yes. Down on Delaware Avenue on the waterfront, they had a lot of women that were brakemen. Yes, both brakemen as on passenger trains as well as brakemen on freight trains, yes. Ah, what was interesting about that, you had to be 25 to work as a brakeman on a passenger train where you punch tickets and yell, you know, next stop, center. But you could be 18 or 20, I mean, there wasn't the same age classification if you worked out in the freight yards, which I thought was kind of interesting. Going up on those and using the baseball bat and it's a lot different than just punching hard. That's kind of interesting. Oh, and I wore just what the men did, beside my bandana and the railroad cap. When it rained, you pulled down over your head an old felt hat where you would find them, you know, in different cars as they went by. And one day, I knew I wanted to go home. I worked, you know, two shifts, and I had my oilskin on and my rain hat. But anyway, I ran, I caught a train, I got off, and I caught another train to my home station. And then I walked across the track, and here are all these girls I grew up with that were their secretaries, and they're dressed very nicely, and so I just see them cringing. Here was this bum coming in, hi, Maisie, hi, Dave. So I walked home that way, and I walked in the back door, and my parents were in the kitchen. And they took one look and couldn't stop laughing. But it was, I think what's hard to explain to people, the era that I grew up in, the time period, is totally different from any time period if you're younger. You just don't know. We did things. I went everywhere on my bicycle. I don't think I would do that today. I would not allow a daughter to do that. In fact, I would be concerned if my son did that unless he was with somebody else. But I went everywhere on my bicycle. Never, ever had a fear. But it's a different time period. You also, it was a period during the war, of course, where there were no men. There was nobody. There were just the woman, and the woman did all kinds of jobs. One of my friends, I think about her because her father came from Germany, but he didn't migrate. He just jumped off a ship in the Delaware River. Swam the shore, became a U.S. citizen. Her mother was Hungarian, and she spoke five languages. Her mother ended up working in one of the big airplane plants like Boeing, but I don't think Boeing was in the East at that time. And they were surprised because her mother spoke and read five languages. And she could take the blueprint and interpret the blueprint and do whatever was necessary. There were a lot of surprises. It's the same as in the old days when you wanted gas in your car, you drove up to the gas station. Someone came out and they put a hose in your car, and you either spent 25 cents or if you had it, you spent $1. And then the next thing you know, it's a woman. It was kind of neat. Did I tell about the slacks?
Yes, you did.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, you did.
Yeah, because I often think about my mother and the slacks. And she said, I'll never talk to her. That's when women started wearing slacks. We didn't do that. It's a different life.
Did any of your high school or college classmates do the kind of thing that you were doing? I mean, that you knew, people you knew.
Well, I don't think I knew anybody.
So you were pretty unusual.
They may have had jobs, but they can work with whoever. And in my place, I think there were only like 4 or 5 young men. But there were no men. What anybody else did, I don't know. But I would say I was the only person I knew on the railroad. But then I climbed trees. I didn't know that was but apparently that's why we started the whole thing with a neighbor, because when they said we've got to get women to work in the railroad, they said, oh, I know someone. And that was me. Anything else?
How did you have time to go to school if you were working double shifts?
Well, you take your school books with you, and you sit and you read and you study. But I also think school at that time, I think about this, was not maybe as demanding as it is today. Which brings me back when you say that, because I remember taking it to that one job called the CR, and I would open a book and read or whatever. But one day there was a young man who was a fireman on one of the 3 trains, and he was waiting for his train to move, and he came in and sat down for him. And we talked, and he had a lovely face. And we talked. It was after I had met him a few times, I did not realize when I said something, his face was lovely. He was a bombardier. His whole face was shattered. It was all one of the first face masks or whatever reconstruction. But he was young, he looked wonderful. But that was a reality of the time period, but you don't think about that. And as far as the young people that I grew up with, or the people, you know, the kids I went to school with, I really don't know. Working, going to school, you lost contact.
Well, Ruthie, I just want to ask you a question. Is your love for the railroad still continued to this day, and in what way?
No, I don't hear you.
What?
Shout.
Ruthie, did you...
I work with Earl. That's the only reason he calls me Ruthie, and they're calling other things, too.
How does your relationship and your love for the railroad today, have you continued?
Oh, I know nothing about it. And the electric trains, you never know. And I go down to Wall and Diane, and we get to the whistle stop for dinner once in a while, and those trains go through, and I think... because there's such power there. Well, there was power when I was 17 or 18, but I was young. It makes a difference when you're young. Some difference.
Your time in the railroad ended.
How did your time in the railroad end?
I graduated from university. The war was over, and the men were coming back, and I knew it was time to move on. So I got a teaching job. I think I was kind of young. I worked at a junior high. Can I tell about?
Yes.
You can. I taught at junior high, phys ed, health. I was a terrible teacher. I could handle the physical part. We could go out and could play games, but I hated teaching hygiene because I thought it was boring. One day I was walking up one of the more fashionable streets at that time in Philadelphia, Chestnut Street, and the cars and the trucks were back to back because they were moving forward as it is in any city, going down to the waterfront. And a truck stopped, the person jumped out of the truck, ran over, grabbed me on the sidewalk, he gave me a big hug and said, "Oh, Miss Hilger, I'll never forget you." And I thought, I wasn't a total failure. But I had a good time, and the kids, I think, enjoyed me. It's just, I hated teaching hygiene. Well, hygiene in the old days, I think, was very boring. I think there are a lot of things you can talk about now. I just can't do that. Oh, when that war started, they asked for people, they had farm wardens, not just farm wardens, what else would we call it at the time? But they were, when they would have the practice where they would put them, you had to turn your lights out in the house, have no light show. I was a runner between the wardens. So why did I get onto that? Oh, because we had to go through a course of how to, like, repair a broken arm or a leg, or what to do for a minor injury, nothing. Trying to get sick.
Okay, a couple more questions in the back. I'll get some questions. You feel like I'm on a talk show? Ruth, can you please tell us when you went to Japan?
Well, that was connected with the military and the wars and things.
When I was teaching school, there were three of us. We were still friends. We were all teaching. But we decided we wanted to go with our bicycles on a hostel trip to Europe. And we were walking down Broad Street, Philadelphia. And as we were talking, we passed, it was a state employment agency. And there was a big sign saying, "Woman wanted in Japan." Well, we looked at each other, and all three of us walked in. We signed up, and we went to Japan. Now, on board the boat, I always think of this. There were different people going to the Orient or to Japan. But I met a businessman, and he said to me, and I never forgot this, he said, "You will find you will either love the Orient or you will hate it." But he said that also, he told me, no matter what your ethnic background is, somewhere in the world you will go and you will say, "This is home." And it has nothing to do with your background or wherever your parents came from. I've never forgotten that because I loved Japan. And I loved the Orient, and I loved the people. And when the Korean business broke out, we were called special services. It really was an outgrowth of the Red Cross and what was the other?
USO.
Singers and whatnot.
USO.
But the point was, I've lost my direction here, that I wanted to talk about. Oh, I know, the Korean War broke out. And the people that I worked under at this club in Sendai, Japan, they took them and left me to run the club when I was really quite new at this, because they had to go help get the hotel set up to get all the people that were fleeing Korea and the times that the things that were happening then. Well, it got so that they were beginning to ship out the wives and the children, and the men were being moved into other positions. And then I remember saying, "Well, what about me?" And they said, "Well, we don't have any rules for you." Well, I was kind of concerned. But I said to the Japanese that worked with me and at the club, I said, "Well, I don't want to go." And they used to say, "Don't worry, Rusan, we'll take it to the caves with us." But, you know, everything got organized and whatever. So I had lots of experiences. The railroad was great, but it's all gone now. It's no longer there in Philadelphia. The people are gone. And I went at a time when life was different. People lived differently. If your parents said you don't do that, you didn't do that. If you were to be in at 10 o'clock at night, you were in at 10 o'clock at night. And now I hear, and I certainly went through this with my daughter, and I found out later that one of the boys at school was coming around knocking on her bedroom window at night, and I know who that is. I just talked to him about it. We we didn't